Yes.
Hi, Bert.
Hi.
Eric speaking.
Good afternoon. Good morning, I have to say, Eric. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon to you. We'll be starting very shortly, as you can imagine. So welcome, everyone. Bonjour à tous. Bienvenue à cette conférence IRCM. Welcome to this IRCM conference. For your information, the session will be recorded. Donc, la séance va être enregistrée. But I think for all of you, except me and Bert, actually, you will not have access to the microphone since this is a conference. So there's no big worry, I think, on your side. Just before we start, I want to invite you to post your questions in the Q&A and avoid using the chat for that purpose. So it is my distinct pleasure to introduce Bert Mollewick. I'm hoping I'm pronouncing your family name correctly.
Perfect, Eric. Perfect.
Thank you so much for joining us. You're a full professor of clinical ethics, support, and quality of care in two institutions. At the Center of Medical Ethics at the University of Oslo in Norway, and also the Department of Ethics, Law, and Humanities at the Amsterdam University Medical Centers, where you also lead the section for ethics support and research integrity, and you're also part of the management team also in that group. My understanding is that Bert has published about 100 peer-reviewed publications. He's been leading many initiatives in health ethics and clinical ethics. He's the co-founder and coordinator of the European Clinical Ethics Network, also of the since 2005, the Dutch Network for Ethics Support since 2016. He's also the general secretary for the executive board of the European Association of Centers for Medical Ethics. For now, I only know Bert through his scholarship. I don't know him personally, but I'm hoping to get to know him as a person because, in my opinion, he has published some of the most interesting papers about the nature of bioethics or health ethics, about the methods of bioethics, about how we can learn from each other as ethical persons or as moral agents. Also about how ethics can be introduced successfully in healthcare institutions. It's a huge challenge. And I think him and his colleagues have very interesting results and experiences to share. And also another important contribution is his work. My English is always very rusty on Mondays after a weekend speaking French. And
Norwegian. Or Norwegian.
Interestingly, he has published very interesting work about how we can evaluate efforts to implement or introduce ethics and to make healthcare practices more ethical. And he's one of the very few scholars who has something interesting to say about the evaluation of outcomes of ethics and ethics deliberation. So I think on all these important topics, he's one of the scholars who has produced maybe some of the most cohesive answers and some of the most original answers and pieces of scholarship. And it's really a pleasure to read you. And now it is a distinct pleasure to welcome you for this conference. I'll be staying in the background, and if there's any technical issue, and I'll be moderating this Q&A, hopefully mostly at the end of the talk to allow you to have a decent amount of time to present your talk today.
Thanks a lot, Eric. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for your warm welcome. And hello, everybody. It's good to, I don't see you, but at least it's good to have the possibility to give some, share some experiences of not only myself, by the way, but my group. I feel a little bit shy if I get all those compliments and nice words. Thanks, though. But of course, this is only possible because of a large group in which I work already for 20 years in clinical ethics support, and empirical ethics. And I'm really honored to have the possibility to share some of our experiences. It will be quite a dense lecture with a lot of information, I think. I remember when I started my PhD that my supervisor said, Bert, less is more. Maybe this applies also to my lecture the next 50 minutes. You have to say it to me later on. But I have a lot to share, not only from my work, but also from my colleagues. And a central aspect in my presentation will be, as Eric said, the work in the clinic, research work, and also more the practical ways of doing clinical ethics in the institutions, in the university hospital, but also in other domains of healthcare. For my presentation, I prepared a PowerPoint, which gives a little bit the possibility to follow my line. And of course, later on, I'm willing to share the PowerPoint as well, not only this lecture, but also the PowerPoint. So I will start to share my PowerPoint. And let's say if this is here, there you are. I first have to close this one. Yeah, let's stop this one. This is another PowerPoint. And this one as well. I think I have to open it. Okay, and now I will start. One moment, please. I'm just my open up again. My PowerPoint. Let's see there. Yeah, there, finally. Thanks for your patience. Okay, I hope you will. Now I have to share it still because I see it. Yes, now we are. And now this one. There we are. Sorry for the delay. So as Eric already said, I have a broad talk. It's not only about clinical ethics support, but also about the role of dialogue in our work, also in our implementation of ethics support work, but also in the evaluation of ethics support. Dialogue is a crucial concept for us. It's not only a matter of the dialogue in, for example, a moral case evaluation, but it's dialogue in an also more abstract sense. Dialogue between practice and theory, dialogue between clinical ethics support and research, dialogue between ethics support and education, etc. So let's give you an overview about what I plan to say this lecture. I'll briefly reflect upon the theoretical necessity of dialogue and some understandings of dialogue. More general, it will not be a deep theoretical part of my presentation, but I think it's important because dialogue is often used as a very broad general concept, and that's not always that's helpful, I think. Then I will introduce ourselves, the Clinic Ethics Support Team at Amsterdam University Medical Centers, to you, a little bit about how we work, the role of dialogue therein, and also the work of our research. And then I start to focus on one aspect or one part of clinical ethics support, and that's moral case deliberation. So I will focus on that, although we are involved in other forms of ethics support like consultation, ethics committees as well. But the case today in my talk will be specifically moral case deliberation. Then, as Eric said, introduced already, I will give some examples of clinical ethics support evaluation studies. There are many more. We are involved in many evaluation studies, but I want to give you two examples of this. And finally, I will end with the vision we have about how to implement or, how do you say, practice ethics support within a clinical context. And what kind of vision do we have, or what kind of theoretical view on ethics support? Who's the owner of ethics support, for example? So I will focus on that in that part of my presentation. I will end with a view on what we call integrative ethics support, because I think with the current forms of ethics support, including the ethics committees, there are really quite some severe challenges that are not always easy to overcome. So we are now, together with my colleagues, we are working on a concept like integrative ethics support. Okay. Well, let me put my... an important presupposition throughout my whole lecture will be that we assume, and of course this is a presupposition, so it's not a true or a claim, but at least in Amsterdam, our theoretical view is that there is no single answer to what is morally right, there is no single truth, and the paradox is that the inherent moral uncertainty and disagreement within ethics has at the same time the potential to bind us. It urges to have a dialogue. And this citation from one of our documents is important to me because I think unless to other professional domains or other professional knowledge domains, ethics in itself has, of course, an uncertain moral domain. It's difficult to found or prove ethical statements or the ethical truth. But the weakness of this, I don't know if it's a weakness, by the way, but the side effect of this is that it urges to have a dialogue together because we cannot prove or we cannot convince the other about a moral truth. We really have to have need the dialogue. And this is, of course, something different when you look at empirical or more descriptive sciences, social sciences, where sometimes at least, well, not with respect to moral conclusions or normative conclusions, but there's the possibility to prove something or to state something, this is. But in ethics, it's not the case. So looking to the concept of dialogue, I think a lot of people, like I said in the beginning, dialogue is seen as something being nice or respectful. And of course, as an ethicist, I think it's important to be nice some way and to be respectful. But in contrast, it can even be unpleasant and yet respectful, the dialogue. So a good constructive dialogue can be provocative and also effective in terms of moving and changing our own presuppositions and opinions or intuitions. So in this way, also in this citation, dialogue is seen as a kind of epistemological vehicle for moral learning, or it's an epistemological given that dialogue is needed in order to reflect or to learn morally. So given this assumption that there is no final moral answer or moral authority, we are doomed to be interdependent in our co-creations of moral answers. And as a matter of fact, I think this is an ongoing process. So even after a huge dialogue of a year or many hours, it is an ongoing process of learning and co-creating, maybe adjusting our moral answers. And I'm not only talking about clinical ethics cases now in the clinic, but even on a more theoretical level, I think ethics or clinic ethics is evolving, and there are different viewpoints or different answers within ethics that changes over time. In that sense, I like this theoretical description. Of course, it's a presupposition that fits within our theoretical background from our group. And I like this picture here, because if you see this picture, then you see that it's not only people that and the saying of people that overlap each other and the meaning of what they are saying and the meaning of the individuals they are, but together they create other colors. And the corals represent then other insights in, well, moral questions or even moral answers. And dialogical approaches to clinic ethics support, there are many dialogical approaches. So I will give some examples. Maybe it's confusing, but because it's not a strict definition of this dialogue, it's more a general description. And on this slide, I will give some approaches to clinic ethics support, which are, I think, dialogical. So far I talked about dialogue as a theoretical understanding of ethics or ethics support. So it's a necessity, it's not only being nice. But of course dialogue, more in the common sense of how people understand the word dialogue, it's also a specific way of communication, which is not that easy, by the way, especially not in ethics. If you are attached to a specific moral viewpoint, then it's difficult to have an open dialogue, active listening, asking questions and instead of starting a debate or discussion or trying to convince the other about your own standpoint. So dialogue, I think, is a kind of, or a dialogical virtue, I would say, of the participants of ethics reflection meetings, whether it is in a committee or in an ethics reflection group or occasion, is quite challenging. especially in ethics, I think. So you could also define dialogue as a way of communicating, which some way opposes discussing or a debate, even a debate. Another approach in our work is the dialogue among participants of clinical ethics support and the ethicist as different yet equivalent epistemological sources. And I know that a lot of ethicists don't agree with me about this point of view, but this means that of course the ethicist has specific knowledge and specific expertise and not only theoretical knowledge, but in a dialogue among clinical ethics support participants and ethicists, we think that those different sources, there's not one source that is more important or dominant or should be more dominant. It is sometimes more dominant, but shouldn't be more dominant than others. So it's a kind of equal participation of those epistemological sources. This, the use of ethical theories and concepts, because that's sort of the reaction we get if I present this the slides like these, that, yeah, but what about the knowledge or the authoritarian statue of ethical theories and concepts? Well, they are important in ethics support. So it's not only that only the participants create moral answers in the end, it's also that in the dialogue that we have with ethics support participants and the ethicist and other people, that ethical theories and concepts play a role as an element, but not as the dominant guiding knowledge source that we should follow. So that's, I think, a small but important, yet important difference. I will talk later about implementation and evaluation, but also when it comes to implementation of ethics support in our, for example, our university hospital in Amsterdam, there are two university hospitals, then we see implementation as well as a dialogue. It doesn't mean that we as experts of moral case relation determine how to implement ethics support. As a matter of fact, although I'm an expert in ethics support, I dare to say, I'm not sure in every context the implementation can be different. So I don't have the final answer how to implement it. So it's a sincere dialogue with every institution, department, clinic, whatever context, because the ethics support is really, it depends on how to implement, it depends on the context and the stakeholders in that context. The development and innovations of clinical ethics support I will talk about in the end, and that's also a kind of dialogue, because we don't determine what an innovation of ethics support is. Of course, we have our ideas about the future of ethics support, but in the end, also the context and the participants, the end users, they also are co-creators of new forms of ethics support. I will give some examples later. And then, as said, the evaluation of ethics support, or more specifically, the evaluation of outcomes of ethics support, is also an ongoing dialogue about meaning, quality, and outcome parameters of ethics support. Again, responsible evaluation here means that the ethics support ethicist or experts and research don't determine beforehand what is the ideal outcome of ethics support. That's something we construct together with the participants or respondents in the evaluation research projects. Okay, so far a little bit about dialogical approaches and about the concept of dialogue, which I now used in many different ways, of course, but to give you a little bit of an idea about at least the consistency of dialogue and the concept of dialogue in our work, and not only in clinical ethics as such. Okay, let me introduce briefly how we are organized at the moment in Amsterdam. Not that it's that important, but I think sometimes it's important that if you hear somebody talk about concepts and research, in what kind of context is he or she working? Well, I'm working at both in Oslo and in Amsterdam. I will focus here in my work in Amsterdam. That's my main part of my job. I work at the Department of Ethics, Law and Humanities. That's a new department since June, because we merged from two ethics centers from two universities. So you can read them there, University of Amsterdam and the VU, or the Vrije University of Amsterdam. So two universities, two big, large academic medical centers, and they are now merging together. And this means that in our department now, there are ethicists working from both universities and from both medical centers. It's quite a large department, as you can see. Well, I think 95 employees is quite large. We have four sections: a section of healthcare law, ethics in care. So ethics in care is all kind of thematic ethics issues like genetics, end of life, the use of coercion, psychiatry, etc. Many more topics, of course. Then there is a section of diversity and participation, which they don't only publish or reflect upon diversity and participation as topic, but they also develop participatory research, participatory projects. And I spend a little bit words on this because that's important in the way we do ethics as well. So although this section is focusing on participative methods for research in general or for constructing policies or the research agenda together with patients, etc., we in ethics support are also influenced by that because we think we develop ethics support also with others in a dialogue, as said before. My own section is a section called Ethics Support and Research Integrity with about 35 employees. So you could imagine those are researchers, teachers, but also ethics support staff. So we have three kind of groups that are working in our section, Ethics Support and Research Integrity. And we have a kind of human resource philosophy that if you want to work at our department, or I have to say at our section specifically, then we expect you to integrate research, doing scientific research, education and teaching, and support services. So you can even see this in the contract. If people get hired in our department, we usually, almost always, want them that they have some activity in research, even if you are a teacher, for example, but also in ethics support services. So that's a kind of... we are working still on this. I'm curious also about how you do this in your practice, but we are working on better integrating research, education, and support services. So if we learn something, for example, in research on ethics support, we will use it in the ethics support service that we deliver. And of course, vice versa. If we learn in practice from our ethics support services that something is needed, then we try to start research in order to, for example, to evaluate it or to make something in this research project. Okay. With respect to ethics support from this department, we can say that this is the kind of ethics support we deliver at the moment. We have two clinic ethics committees from the two medical centers. There is a lot of moral case deliberation going on, both moral case deliberation facilitated from the department, our department, but also, and that's important, I think, if you talk about dialogue and implementation, it's also that we, in the last 10 years, trained a lot of nurses, managers, physicians, doctors, specialists to become an MCD facilitator themselves. So at the moment, I think about 20 clinical wards, they are using MCD as a kind of ethics support. Maybe also, they also use the advice from clinic ethics committee, but with respect to moral case relation, 20 wards now have a structural attention or have moral case relation themselves. But it doesn't mean that we always from the department, from the university department, go to the wards. It's also that because we don't own clinic ethics support. We don't own moral case variation. So it's in our viewpoint that, of course, we think we have specific expertise and we are needed. In the end, we think ethics expertise, clinic ethics expertise, should be embedded in practice and in the professions that work there. Then we do something like moral counseling. We have, of course, individual ethics consultation. There's ethics education, of course, like in every university. There's also moral case relation as a kind of education. So then we use the methodology of moral case relation in education specifically, no matter what the topic is, and in research. I will give an example in which we used MCD as a research instrument, so moral case relation. And I will give some examples of how we used it and how we developed kind of moral compass out of a series of moral case variation. Finally, we have quite some responsive participatory research projects on ethical issues. For example, at the moment, we are busy with developing a tool for creating or fostering or stimulating a fair distribution of beds in the hospital. And that's, of course, a tough issue and a difficult issue, because what is a fair distribution of the beds in an academic hospital or in a regular hospital? And we have now a participatory research project in which we work together with clinicians and the managers, how we can support this difficult process of distribution of beds every day, every morning they are doing this. Okay, so this is a kind of ethics report. These are the explicit kinds of ethics support. And just to be clear, that there is, of course, a lot of implicit ethics support going on always at the coffee corner or wherever. So I don't want to claim that only in those moments or with those activities we are doing ethics support. Because then again, you are trying to claim the activity or even the domain of ethics. And I think that's not realistic, but also not desirable. Okay. This is a slide in between, which gives an idea. It's all from my colleague, Linda Douwersen. She used to work at our department a long time ago. And this is from her thesis in 2013. So the data is a little bit outdated because this is from 2011, I guess, this data. But it gives you a little bit idea about how at that time, almost 9 years ago, 10 years ago, clinic ethics support was present in the Netherlands. This was based on a large grant from the Ministry of Health. The Ministry of Health in the Netherlands helped us quite a lot to develop ethics support in the Netherlands. So here you see that the general hospitals, that most of the ethics support style forms was the ethics committees, then moral case evaluation, and then ethics consultation. And the same somehow also applies for the other domains, mental health care, elderly care, and care for disabled. But specifically in psychiatry, the mental health care, you see that moral case evaluation is huge present, more than, for example, in the hospital. I have some ideas about why this is the case, why it was the case 10 years ago. So it's domain specific. I think this slide shows that it's domain specific how people spend time to ethics support in the first place, but also what kind of ethics support. Okay, what kind of moral questions are we confronted with? And of course, we have, well, a thousand of moral questions, but I want to give you especially a slide on the variety of moral questions that we are dealing with as clinic ethics support service and as clinic ethics support researchers. So I'm not talking only about the service that we deliver, but also about the research we do. What is the right timing to use coercion? I think that's a nice well-known clinical question, not only in the hospital and in elderly care, but also in psychiatry, of course. So what is the right timing? When are we too late or too early with using coercion? Should we use coercion in the first place? Of course, that's also a moral question that is related to that question. Should we cover the high cost for this rare disease? So here you see another kind of moral question that we are confronted with, and that's more on the level of the board of directors, or the contracts that the contracts that they are building with pharmacy companies, for example. And I'm very glad and proud that the board of directors also posed this question to us as ethics support service, that they want to discuss about this. Is shared decision making a duty for the clinical patient? Well, this is, I think, a very well-known clinical ethics case or moral question. When are we allowed to dismiss a patient who does not want to cooperate? Again, I think a well-known topic and a difficult one, not only in general somatic healthcare, but also in psychiatry, for example, or in people that are patients that are addicted. When should we dismiss an employee? Well, I'm a leader of a section, and this is also a human resource kind of moral question, which we are confronted with. Not only myself as a leader, sometimes section leader, but also that other managers or leaders come to us and that they want to discuss about this, or that the human resource advisors want to talk about this. How should we facilitate? What is a fair reason for dismissing an employee after how many problems, after how long trying to function better and better and better? So this is certainly also a moral question for us for ethics support. Are we allowed to use money for advertising our hospital? Again, more on the organizational ethics domain, but very relevant. When is it justified that the supervising professor is mentioned as author on a paper of the PhD student? Well, this is more in the field of research integrity, which is also in my section. But of course, this is also a moral question that you could tackle either with the ethics committee, or you could discuss this within moral case relations among researchers and PhD students. Whatever. We are now involved in quite some large research integrity, European research integrity projects. And this case is a very case that happens many times. in all those categories of ethical challenges in daily life, independent of what ethicists write about it, we saw that this slide is from empirical research in which we saw different categories of ethical challenges. And I think as an ethics support staff, and even as a researcher in ethics support, it's good to distinguish between the different categories. There are more categories, of course. It's just to be clear when I talk to nurses or managers or doctors that I try to find out what kind of ethical challenge is this? What kind of category? I do not know what is morally good in the situation, or I know it, but I have different values that compete with each other. That's maybe a kind of internal personal dilemma that I experience, but it can also be that the dilemma is more within the team. Yeah? This is the third bullet. We have different viewpoints within our team about what is morally good. Sometimes, especially policy officers, they say, well, we know our values, but we have different viewpoints about what a certain value should mean in practice. So that's also something we tackle in moral case races now and then. Or we know what is morally good, but we are not able to do it. Well, this is, I think, some of you recognize this as a kind of example of moral distress, which there is a lot of literature about.
Bert, I'm sorry. We have a small clarification question, which perhaps we could tackle right away. One of the participants asked, is there any triage regarding which instance will answer the question that the department will have received? For example, will it be the clinical ethics committee? Will it be a moral case deliberation or an individual ethics consultation? How is that decided?
Yeah, that's a nice question. It used to be, it's now, at the moment we have, for example, we have, as ethics support service, we have one telephone number, we have one email, and one internal website, intranet. But still, so the question is that the triage is sometimes in this central email address or central telephone number, where one of my colleagues is the coordinator of ethics support's request. And then she determines whether this is a moral case deliberation issue or a clinic ethics committee issue. Of course, this is the kind of rational answer. In practice, people sometimes know the ethics committee ethicist or know the ethicist as a sole consultant. So in practice, this is more blurred or more unclear, I think. But we are now moving towards more clarity, and we also have some video trailers and a kind of menu on the intranet net site and video trailers about all the ethics support we offer. And in order to try to help the people, for what kind of ethics support should you, can you contact us, and what kind of ethics support is maybe appropriate. Is this an answer, Eric?
Well, yeah, I think it. We can come back to it in the discussion period if it wasn't clear. I think it was very clear. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. But this is, I think there is not for each request for ethics support, there is not only one specific form of ethics support that is appropriate, I think. You can, it depends a little bit, of course, but maybe later. Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Eric. And please interrupt me if there are other questions for a clarification. Okay. So this part is about moral calibration. Again, it's just an example of ethics support form, but we are quite active in this form. And it also shows well the role of dialogue in this. I will move a little bit to this. Yeah. So what is moral case relation? It's a practical way of doing ethics in concrete practices with an ethicist or, and it's important to say, a trained facilitator. So I think only some ethicists in my department, or some people facilitated in my department are ethicists, but usually they are either other academic colleagues with an academic degree or PhD degree, but it could also be, like I said before, the nurse, the manager that received a training. I decided not to talk about the training we deliver, because we have been training facilitators, I think 1,000 now, since the last 9 years, so we are quite active there nationally and internationally. We even will now start an online training for MCD facilitators soon in the next year. And then the fact that we have to do this online is, of course, also an advantage for people from abroad. But I will not talk about it, because that's too much for today. So in MCD, participants have a dialogue together between practitioners about their moral question. That's also important, because how to define or find a moral question, I will speak about that in some minutes. So this is usually grouped together for 45 minutes, sometimes even 30 minutes, but can also take 2 hours. It's a real question in a real case, so not like in ethics education, sometimes hypothetical cases. No, this is a real question. And we are using a specific conversation method, such as the dilemma method. I will show the dilemma method right away. A trained facilitator is fostering dialogue and moral inquiry, and there's a process and outcome oriented. So we should have a good process and also a good outcome. What a good outcome is in every time we do MCD is, of course, a question, because that's not given beforehand. So moral case raising is radical concrete, is a collective inquiry into a central question. It's especially about moral knowledge and moral wisdom. And in that respect, every participant is equal, like I said at the beginning about dialogue. It's learning about differences and disagreements. I think the nice thing about moral case relation is that it can stimulate to have constructive disagreements because of this epistemological view on clinical ethics. And its MCD is focusing on experiential learning. Not only, we include ethical theories and concepts as well, but experiential learning is a very important epistemological source. We ask participants to avoid hypothetical reasoning or authoritative claims because we think it doesn't fit with our epistemological view on clinical ethics within MCD. It can be different if you have an expert group developing a kind of policy, but maybe I will talk about that later. So MCD is not something only for academic persons. It's not aiming at the truth or the true answer. It's also not about finding who is right. And of course, as a facilitator, that's very important that participants be aware that they don't start a debate or a discussion. It's not aiming at abstract philosophy or ethics wisdom in an abstract way, at least. And it's not also about teaching ethics or giving advice. And for some of you who are involved as consultants in clinical ethics support, I think you recognize a little bit also the approach described by Marco Lucio about the facilitator approach as a consultant. It's not sometimes a consultant can give advice, of course, but usually it's also a lot about facilitating learning and reflecting. Goals of moral case relation specifically is usually on the case level. Usually clinicians and manager think, well, we need a moral case relation because of this case. But we have quite a lot of projects in which we use moral case relation as all for goals on the professional level. For example, to decrease the amount of moral distress, to increase the moral competency, a kind of self-care. So moral self-care, not self-care as such, but how to stay faithful to my own virtue, my own values in my professional life. And of course, moral case relation is also used, also in our research, we do a lot of research on this aspect, that MCD is used for goals on the team level. For example, better cooperation, better understanding, better decision-making processes, etc. And finally, not that often, but MCD, sometimes we use, for example, 6 MCDs on a specific topic to use the MCDs as research and to develop a kind of policy out of this, the arguments from those MCD sessions. Sorry, this is a kind of example of the dilemma method. To be clear, there are, in the Netherlands, we wrote a book about 10 conversation methods for moral case relation. So this is only one conversation method, it's the dilemma method. And to make it even more difficult, there are different variations of the dilemma method. So we should be flexible here, or at least careful. So there are different methods to organize your moral case relation session, and this is one example. And this is articulating about the dilemma. It's about articulating the dilemma. It's the dilemma of the case presenter. So that's also important. I will tell a little bit more about that later. Here you see the steps. I think some of you recognize those who deal with clinical cases that it's first to get the question or the problem from the case presenter. That's a specific term we use, case presenter. And then, of course, it's participants that have to know the facts and elucidation of the case. Then we are collecting value norms. And then it's a kind of looking for alternatives, well, individual weighing. So this is quite an intense process with a lot of steps, I think. And it depends a little bit of the goal. If the team asks me to have a moral case relation with the dilemma method, only by getting to know each other's viewpoints, then we even don't need to have a conclusion about what to do. Then it's enough that we share each other's viewpoints on the case, and then we can stop the MCD. So again, even the steps are depending on the goal of the specific team, the goal of that the team has with this MCD. Now some nice examples. Because of the time, I will go a little bit further, faster. But these flights is an example of how we use MCD, not only individual cases, but also for example, building a policy on sexuality and mental health care. Or that we organized MCD sessions focusing on moral dilemmas with family participation and informal care. So there we developed a moral compass. With most of those examples, we also have specific papers, but they are not on this slide, but we have specific English papers, so I could share this later on. So as a matter of fact, to be honest, as a clinical ethics support, I like to have good MCDs. But what I most like is that MCD contributes to a kind of concrete results to morally improve the practice by this kind of examples. So this is what I like about MCD, that we work together with clinicians, managers, etc., to learn from the MCD session. So not only from the MCD session itself, which already is often a very rich learning environment, but then with the insights, I'm very eager and passionate to make something out of it and to help the practice and the people, the stakeholders in the practice further. Not only saying, this was a fantastic MCD session, and now we're going back to our work, but trying to use the insights of ethics support activities for future further improvements. And this is a slide, the next slides are a little bit about the theoretical viewpoint on moral case relations, and maybe also in clinic ethics support general. I will talk about it briefly because I also want to have a little bit minute time for some research examples. But as you can see, we have quite some papers about it, even more papers than here. We have written papers about it, that we are inspired by a kind of pragmatic hermeneutics, in which experience is one of the primary sources of wisdom. And we are also inspired by Aristotle and Nussbaum, and also by the role of emotions, also in MCD. Sometimes we are inspired by the view of the moral epistemology of Socratic, like in Socratic dialogues, where experience is also seen as a kind of source. And I already said to you that experiential learning is an important viewpoint on how we want to do and use ethics. These are some examples that which fits with our theoretical understanding that, for example, there is no specific one single moral dilemma in a situation. So even if people say, Bert, we want to have a moral case relation about this specific situation, theoretically, I'm always very careful not to think that there is one moral case or one moral question. And usually that's also why we use the term moral case presenter, because even if the team says to me, well, this is our moral question, I'm very sensitive and careful about who is formulating which moral question. And I think that experiencing a moral dilemma yourself, I sometimes experience a moral dilemma myself as well, then I experience that my dilemma changes in the process itself. So for example, the sentence, moral answer is not before and given, it arises out of the dialogue. That's especially what is needed in our dialogical approach to MCD. Okay, this is a little bit repetition of what I said so far. And I think I've said most of the elements here already, that there is no one right dilemma. So if I write down the dilemma on the flip chart, for example, then I always put a name of this is the dilemma according to Bert. I don't presuppose that it's everybody's moral dilemma. This is just to give a few about how a value and norm scheme in the dilemma method looks like. Of course, it's very simplified, But you see that left there is the column with perspectives, of course, many more perspectives than only the nurse and the patients in this case. Then you see the values and norms. First the values and then the norms, but we can also work vice versa, that we start with norms and then going back to values. And you see an A and a B. So this in this specific case, the nurse experienced a dilemma. The patients didn't experience a dilemma. So the patient only experienced values or norms for option B. That is, that he or she didn't want to have food at all. But the nurse experienced a dilemma. So here in the figure in this table, you see that for the nurse herself or himself, there was a conflict between respect for autonomy and the well-being of the patient. This is a quite simple case, of course, but I hope it gives you an idea about how we actually write things down and connect it to the A and B option within a dilemma. I will skip this for the time being because, Eric, we have another, 7 minutes, is that right?
Yes, ideally, we have a couple of questions already to tackle in the Q&A, so.
Yeah.
Ideally. Thank you.
So then I will use the last 5 minutes maybe to talk a little bit about research of ethics support. These are just some, relevant and important slides about the normative status of ethics support stuff in general. This is a nice paper from Stella Reiter-Teil. This is about research, and I really like this graphic because it's something what I just said about to you, that it's nice to have a valuable meeting or MCD session, but I'm so eager to really contribute to something and to catch something and to learn from it. So when we talk about evaluation of ethics support research, I always show this drawing because it's a kind of cynical drawing that somehow we also should aim perhaps more than we do in ethics support to bring the lessons learned forward beyond the specific ethics support activity. I will see what I can say in the last 4 minutes. Research plays an important part in our work. As I said, if we start a project on ethics support topic, for example, fair distribution of beds, then we try to develop a kind of guideline of compass or whatever how you call it, but we all also use this as a kind of research project. So a lot of our papers are published together with the requesters for ethics support in the past. And that's really a nice way of work together that you combine research and ethics support. Research is also needed, I think, evaluation research of ethics support is needed for the co-creation of ownership of ethics support. And often I have been frustrated because they called me for ethics support, then they sent me back to my university department, and then the clinic is going further with this important case and the follow-up of this case. But I think it's important that in evaluation research, if I ask the requesters for ethics support how they like or not like the ethics support, what their goal is and how we could use it or improve it, then we are truly cooperating together and trying to improve the ethics support as such. So I don't believe anymore in a kind of consultancy where I do my thing and then go back to the university. I think it's really important to have an ongoing cooperative relationship. I will skip this maybe, sorry for that. This is a little, then two examples of evaluation research I want to show to you. This is a slide in which you can see that we have done a lot of research, but a lot of evaluation research, so now I'm talking about evaluation research, is only presented by what participants experience at outcomes. And as a matter of fact, we are now busy with trying to develop research designs in which we want to somehow describe or measure both qualitative and quantitative how ethics support truly contributes to a better, whatever that is, of course, because that's the question in ethics support, a better quality of care or a better team cooperation. So although there's a lot of research on ethics support, I think we need really going towards more co-creations of contributions to quality of care, including observational studies and even maybe randomized studies, but that's of course an ethical issue in itself. Here you see some interesting references for ethics support. The two examples, very brief though, so I give you some time for questionings, from your questions. Two examples of a dialogic approach to clinical ethics support evaluation. The one is the, it's called the EuroMCD, and this is a European research instrument that measures or try to describe outcomes of MCD. In the last 6 years, we have been working to develop the EuroMCD 2.0, so the second one. In 2014, it was the first one. Why do I give this example? Because in this project, this was the thesis of Janina de Snow-Trimp. You can even find the English version of the new EuroMCD on her website or on our website, the EuroMCD website. Why I show this example is because that we as ethicists and researchers didn't define what the 15 outcomes should be of MCD. So in the way we constructed and validated and studied this new EuroMCD questionnaire, now with 15 outcome measures in three categories, you see them on the slide, we didn't define it yourself. So this is a kind of dialogical example of how do we determine what is an appropriate outcome of MCD. We needed the participants, we needed focus groups, etc. So this was a dialogical process in itself. And in the last chapter of the thesis of Janina de Snow-Trimp, she just defended her thesis on the EuroMCD in October last month, and she got a cum laude degree even. In the last chapter of her thesis, she writes about this complex process of collecting empirical data about appropriate outcomes of MCD, and also theoretical viewpoints about appropriate outcomes of MCD. And this she tried to integrate in the new version of the EuroMCD. Here you see an example. So these are this is the EuroMCD, the 2.0. And you see the three domains and the several items. But again, you can see them and read about it on the specific website. Final example, and then I stop. I have been founding the Dutch Network for Ethics Support in the Netherlands called NEON. And there we had a project about the quality of ethics support. Again, in this project, we developed 80 or 85 characteristics of qualitative ethics support. But again, we didn't determine or formulate it from our desk or from the books, but we asked all participants of this network, so the ethics support staff in the Netherlands, we asked them to participate with us and together in a kind of dialogue using empirical social scientific research, creating what kind of quality characteristics do we need if we talk about quality of ethics support. So we have wrote some papers about it, so that's easy to refer to. But in the end, we used the dialogical approach here again is that we don't determine it beforehand, but that we develop it with the practice and the stakeholders in that practice. This is just a description of this process. And we also have a publication, I think it's here. Yeah, this paper from Baarle et al. Lessons learned from last year in BMC Medical Ethics is about this process of dialogical learning about the quality of ethics support. Okay, Erik, I could talk for some more hours, but I'll stop for now in order to be able to have a dialogue with you and not only talk by myself. Thanks a lot for your patience thanks for your attention.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Very, very dense, interesting talk, broaching a wide range of topics. We have a couple of questions. We'll try to tackle them if we have the time. First question is, in your opinion, what could be the three main aspects that need to be present in a moral case deliberation to say that quality was there?
That the quality was there of the MCD.
Yeah.
That's a good, there are many aspects of the quality of MCD, but now I would say there should be a sincere moral question. So that's about quality, that there's a kind of condition in order to have a good MCD session. Furthermore, there should be a good, I think, structure, not too rigid, of course, but a structure and a facilitator. So in Europe, we would say we call something a good MCD if there is a good moral question, sincere. I And then we need, of course, the case presenter to determine this, a good facilitator with a conversation method, and then most important, to have a sincere, critical dialogue in which also disagreements are dealt with constructively.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Next question from Michel Jean, who is a bioethicist and a policymaker and very interesting person. I wish you could be here with us to meet all these fascinating people that are listening to you.
Yeah.
She's asking, in the policymaking process, can you be more explicit about how your methods can be applied?
In the policy making process, of course, it's that requires maybe more details and more time to explain it, but to be brief, if we want to develop policy with the use of ethics support, then first of all, we sit together with, for example, the policymakers or the people that want this policy in order to think about the content and the use and the goal of this policy. Then we start with ethics support activities, and of course, different ethics support activities will help with developing policy. So not every ethics support activity is necessary there. But for example, we developed a policy about transgender operations for young people when they are between 12 and 14. There we had started a meeting with the management and the treatment teams of the transgender clinic in Amsterdam. Then we had MCD sessions, more case-based sessions, about specific young people that want this transgender transformation and the pros and cons about it. And then based on the additional interviews we developed and the literature and the results from the MCD sessions, we came up with a kind of guideline, normative guideline, for how to deal with very young people that want to have this transgender operation. This is very brief, I am sorry, but I will next time I can tell more about it. Or I can refer to a paper in which we describe this.
Certainly I can convey the information. Maybe one of the last questions here from Professor Pascal Lehoux. She's an expert in technology assessment, health technology assessment and responsible innovation at Investin Montréal. And she's asking, commending you on the talk, and asking to what extent do you think that MCD methods will be needed to handle practical issues arising from the use of digital tools and artificial intelligence in the clinic or hospital governance? Do you have any ideas or ongoing work to share at this point on these topics?
If I understood the question well, Eric, it's the question about whether MCD or maybe ethics support in general can help to deal with online and artificial intelligence issues in healthcare institutions.
Yeah.
Okay. Just checking. Yeah. Okay. As a matter of fact, we in 2 weeks we will have not about algorithms and artificial intelligence, but we will have some moral case relations. We call it open moral case relations in the clinic, in which we will talk about the moral side of digital healthcare and online healthcare. So that's one topic. And as a matter of fact, I wrote an application, a European grant application, about the role of ethics support and the growing impact of big data, of course, and the algorithms in big data and how it influenced the decision making in the clinic. Unfortunately, the European Union didn't grant this honor this grant, but this is this is a huge topic, and I certainly think that ethics support here could be helpful also in how to think about what kind of impact all those the implication of all those data and also the normativity of algorithms that impact government, of course, and policy, to make this more explicit. And I think, well, I could talk, but this is, so yes, but it's also new for us. I think the person asked it, but it's new for us, and I think it needs more attention, because I foresee a lot of, talking about epistemology, I see a lot of moral tensions and challenges if decision-making is more and more steered by, data that we cannot direct understand or reveal. Yeah.
Maybe a last short but interesting question from Professor Jocelyne Saint-Arnaud. She's a professor emeritus from Université Montréal and an expert in nursing ethics. She would probably have much to share with you given your shared backgrounds. She's asking, do you think that laws and jurisprudence should be the basis for the evaluation in clinical ethics?
Law and jurisprudence?
Jurisprudence, yes.
No. My first initiative, I think for the evaluation of ethics support, that's what you ask, isn't it?
Yes, I believe. Yes.
Yeah. When it comes to the evaluation of ethics support, I think evaluation is a normative activity. So I think we need, of course, we use law and regulations, and there we can evaluate some impact of ethics support or the quality of ethics support. But my basic point of view here is that to evaluate ethics support, we need the users and the stakeholders in practice, not only to evaluate ethics support, but also to reflect on a meta level on what kind of evaluation criteria we construct. And that's a kind of constructive approach, how to say, in which outcomes parameters or success criteria are not determined by beforehand only by law or regulations or policy.
Okay, well, we managed to go through the question list at the end. Thank you so much for covering so much ground and providing us an overview, which I think, I hope for those who did not know your work will be an invitation to read more in your papers about all the topics that you touched upon today. We have a time scheduled to talk together with my group, so I have many questions, but I wanted to spare the time for others. We thank you very much. We were about 40 people listening to you and a lot of interesting people that I hope you'll have a chance to come and meet here in Montreal physically once everyone has maybe the vaccine that was announced this morning or another one. So thank you so much. Thanks to everyone for joining, and stay tuned for upcoming seminars. And Bert will give you a break, and we'll be reaching out to you in about 25 minutes.
Again, thanks again, Eric, for your invitation to give this lecture. And it was not a real dialogue with you, so I'm really looking forward to have this dialogue, not only online, but even maybe in Montreal. Thanks again, and please contact me if you have further questions or criticism about my talk. Email myself, and I would be honored to continue the dialogue. Thanks.
Thank you.
Merci.
Merci beaucoup.